to something shocking now. Heaven knows anything goes. Good authors too, who once knew better words, now only use four-letter words. Writing prose, anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and day's night today, when most guys today that women prize today are just silly gigolos. So though I'm not a great romancer, I know that I'm bound to answer when you propose. Anything goes.
Good evening, once again from the Emerald City. I find it difficult to appear cheerful lately in that the last few shows have come in the wake of bad news. First the Everara tragedy, and more recently our setback in Florida last week. Hopefully most of you are aware that the Florida incident, while indeed unfortunate, is not the end of the world. You may be reassured to know that the National Gay Task Force, along with hundreds of concerned groups nationwide, are working full-time on preventing the further spread of the Florida virus before it can reach epidemic proportions. As with most epidemics, a vaccine is necessary and there are costs involved. If you can see fit, please make your donation to the National Gay Task Force, 85th Avenue, New York, New York, 10011. That's the National Gay Task Force, 85th Avenue, New York, New York, 10011. Look at it as just another form of insurance. In this case, it's insurance on your liberty. Moving on to a lighter note. Coming up shortly on tonight's program, we'll be seeing some scenes of a show currently appearing at the top of the Village Gate, entitled Mama's Boys. After that, we'll be visited by Dr. C.A. Tripp, noted psychologist and author of The Homosexual Matrix. Speaking with him will be actor Ken Kleiben. Later, it's off to La Mama and John Vaccaro's Playhouse of the Ridiculous in Kenneth Bernard's The 60-Minute Queer Show. In the words of the director, don't let the title fool you. It's nothing like what you might expect. George Sardi is out recovering from his vacation in Haiti. Harry Harp Brown will be here later with a commentary, and he will also be spending 5 minutes with Stevie Knowles, a spokesperson for the Christopher Street Liberation Day Committee. All in all, we feel that you'll find tonight's show different, and the only way that you'll find out is to stick around. We'll be right back with some of Mama's Boys after this.
Wondering what this world's about. I know a place that has the answer.
Chaps, 3rd Avenue between 87th and 88th.
From the top of the Village Gate, it's Mama's Boys.
I'm a self-made woman who knows her ass from a hole in the ground. I'm educated and liberated. I know whose end is up and who's going down. I get so tired of so-called called men, treating us gentle and so sickening sweet. When will you ever learn? It's not how good you are, but how bad that knocks a girl off her feet.
You gotta help me.
A live nude girl. Would one of you boys like to give it a try? I'd like to show you my latest position. Put your head between your legs and kiss your ass goodbye. Is Helen ready? Does Lucille ball? You bet your ass you. Does a chicken have a pecker? I don't know. I've got equipment you've never dreamed of. What's Wonder Woman without leather and whips?
You gotta hit on me.
You didn't think I'd be this tall, did you? Hello, mothers. I'm the Virgin Mary. And I am here to discuss with you. Susan, please, can't you simply give me a light that makes me look about 23? I never cease to marvel at the quickness of your mind. Now to the point. I am here to discuss with you a problem that is common to mothers of all sorts, divine, profane, and just plain ordinary. Now, are you out there? There you are. Now, as you may well be aware, the conception may have been immaculate, but this kid is one holy mess. Yes, yes indeed, the messy Messiah. Oh my Christ. Wait a minute, that has a ring to it. Now, where was I?
This is why.
Thank you, dear Mr. Kilgore. This is why. Please pay attention. You, please. This is why, thank you. I use poopers, the disposable diaper. Now, I must tell you, they are sturdy, super absorbent, and soft enough for God. Therefore, if your kid is like my kid, and we've simply got to face the facts, nobody's perfect. Well, with perhaps the exception of one or two. So if shitty diapers, I mean, if soiled diapers are your cross to bear, I must remember to keep shaking my head back and forth. Grown man standing here dressed this way. If soiled diapers are your cross to bear, next Christmas, give him a little confidence and turn the other cheek with poopers. Thank you. Good night. You're all mine.
Miss Catherine Hepburn for Poopers Disposable Diapers.
Do you have gas problems that have nothing to do with the energy crisis? Well, here's a word from Mass Gas.
Roger, I don't want us to be late. But I really should. Let's go.
Why are you walking so slowly?
Am I walking slowly?
Oh, I'll put that in the trunk.
Mass Gas is a unique new heavy-duty air freshener for those difficult moments. Mass Gas comes in a variety of sizes for your purse, for your home, and for your safety.
You
You know what I forgot? Melba, meet the couple we're doubling with. Larry, Lana, this is Melba. Melba, Larry, Lana.
Mask Gas. They don't have to know what you do.
Skip, your left breast is exposed, ma'am.
Oh, my God, I must have left the baby on the bus.
Mama, 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 yo quiero. Mama, yo quiero. Mama, yo quiero, mama.
Your hand out of your pants, you're gonna go blind. Get out of my closet. You ever been attacked by a fruit salad?
Welcome to Emerald City. We're very pleased to have with us this evening Dr. C.A. Tripp. Dr. C.A. Tripp is the author of The Homosexual Matrix, now in paperback, published by Signet Press. Dr. Tripp has a doctorate in psychology from New York University. He was closely associated with Dr. Alfred Kinsey and the Institute for Sex Research for 9 years, and for 9 years was on the faculty of the State University of New York. Dr. Tripp, good evening. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Dr. Tripp, many of us have experience with therapists and psychologists and psychiatrists, but not too many of us have had close contact in the flesh, so to speak, with a sex researcher. Can you tell us, describe some of your work with Dr. Kinsey in the 9 years that you were with the Sex Institute, and just give us an idea of what is involved in being a sex researcher, give us an idea of some of the hazards or pleasures, if there are any.
Well, you're right. There's an enormous difference between sex researchers and psychiatrists. Psychologists and psychiatrists are very concerned with social mores and how things hit the society. Sex researchers really don't give a damn about what the layman or the man in the street thinks about something. He is primarily interested in the differences between people and in sexuality, the difference between sexuality and different societies, which is enormous, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
This difference, by the way, is what got Dr. Kinsey into trouble more than 20 years ago, because at that time, the only psychology that one heard was from psychiatry. While Kinsey's findings were all centerline sex research and seemed awfully contradictory, for instance, to speak of extramarital relationships or homosexuality or animal intercourse without batting an eye and without passing moral judgments. This is something that I'm afraid even Freud didn't do.
Mm-hmm. What, when you were working with Dr. Kinsey, what did you have a special area of research that you were particularly interested in those during those 9 years?
No, I started out doing the blacklight photography for them. That isn't generally known by the public, but Kinsey and his research team did a lot of photography mm-hmm. of human subjects to check such things as the difference and similarities between male and female orgasm, and to see something about the variations that exist between people according to social level, according to mm-hmm. Ethnic background, and so on. So that was the way it started with the so-called black light work. It ended with very much more sophisticated experimental mm-hmm. Things that we did together.
Do you find that as a sex researcher and a psychotherapist, there is any animosity, let's say, extended to you from therapists who don't have that particular background? Are there any distrust of you? Or
yes, from therapists who are orthodox in their particular beliefs. It doesn't much matter which beliefs they are. An orthodox Freudian or a William Allianson Whitean or an Adlerian, if they're orthodox, that rather means that they are stuck with the package they're stuck mm-hmm. with. The eclectic therapists who borrow from people of different disciplines accept it quite quickly.
Mm-hmm. What made me ask that is I happened to hear a kind of mini debate between you and Dr. Socarides, who, for those who may not know, apparently is the leader in the American Psychiatric Association of those who believe that homosexuality is a psychosexual disorder. Is that true?
Yes. Dr. Socarides and three other psychiatrists represent the minority opinion, and they were the ones who were so shocked when the American Psychiatric mm-hmm. Association voted 3 years ago to declassify homosexuality mm-hmm. as a mental illness. So they demanded a referendum, and to everyone's surprise, including mine, by the way, it turned out that the psychiatrists were about 70% in favor of the new declassification.
That's an interesting statistic in light of the Dade County elections, which also turned out to be 70%. But I wondered how the conventional psychiatrists, such as Dr. Socarides, react to the fact when you, as a sex researcher, present certain statistics verifying your findings. In other words, if they're stuck with the old package, as you put it, how do they respond when you present them with these statistics of your research?
My claim is that one of the ways they respond is to not read the literature. However, if you force them to look at the literature, then they frequently find small cop-outs. For example, they like phrases like obligatory homosexuality, which means a person who is obliged to be homosexual, as if everyone isn't obliged to be whatever they are.
Mm-hmm.
They never speak of obligatory heterosexuality or obligatory black shoe fetishism or 50 other things they might get into.
Mm-hmm. I would like to take a quote from your book and have you comment on it. By the way, we're talking about a book, The Homosexual Matrix, just to give you a few news quotes on it. The Times, New York Times said, 10 years in the making, this monumental study broadens our minds and explodes our misconceptions sky high. Psychology Today, the best book on homosexuality I ever read, and I could go on and on. Dr. Tripp, you wrote, it is still widely believed that homosexuality stems from identity problems, a fear of the opposite sex, from various infantile fixations, and most palpably of all, from parental influence. Now, this, I gather, is what you refer to as the standard package that the psychiatrists have been giving us.
Yes, they have now managed to, psychiatry has now managed to sell that to the man on the street.
Mm-hmm.
None of those particular theories hold up,
right.
By the way.
May I ask, is it too much to ask you in the short time that we have to ask you what, in your book, what types of ideas have you replaced those with, those ideas that we've all been brought up with?
Well, a central one that has been put forth, it's not my idea, it's very much Kinsey and Beach who hit upon it, is that a person's sexuality will not work, whatever it is, unless they have eroticized whatever the object is. Mm-hmm. You can't be a black shoe fetishist unless you have eroticized black shoes. You can't be a homosexual even for 5 minutes unless you have managed to eroticize same-sex attributes.
Mm-hmm.
And once you have eroticized same-sex attributes, that will stamp your homosexuality as very much like that of someone who may do nothing else. The same is true of heterosexuality.
Mm-hmm.
Heterosexuality only works to the extent that you learn to eroticize opposite-sex attributes. And this whole concept of understanding that something has to be eroticized before it can gain any kind of sexual meaning is utterly foreign to the layman. It's a pity in a way because it keeps people in a jail of ignorance about all kinds of sexual variations.
May I ask, is it clear the manner in which, for instance, one young male would eroticize same-sex attributes, whereas another young male would eroticize opposite-sex attributes. Is that process clear?
It is only clear in particular spots. By the way, it's not very clear in heterosexuality either. We know in heterosexuality that some people simply pick up the advice and example that they see in front of them,
mm-hmm.
examples, and simply copy it. But in many other cases, it takes individual learning, not necessarily from practice, but from the first there has to be a buildup of what sex researchers called a value system, a sexual value system that determines what's exciting, what's arousing, what's important,
mm-hmm.
What a person admires enormously, and so on. If you pin a sex researcher right down and say, well, tell me exactly why Johnny and not Billy has this or that sex preference, we can't do it without individual study mm-hmm. in great detail.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that everyone agrees on, regardless of the school of thought, is that in well over 90% of instances, sexual orientation is fully determined by the age of 5.
Right. Well, that's an interesting point. I think it can bring us to the next topic of discussion, something that's come up in Dade County recently. For those of you watching, we are talking to Dr. Tripp just a couple of days after the Dade County election. And what I wanted to ask you, Doctor, is what type of mentality exactly are we dealing with in Dade County? It's easy enough to say, to characterize Ms. Bryant as perhaps a religious fanatic or a kook, but when we're dealing with 70% of the population of Dade County, it's sort of hard to just group them all and say these are all a bunch of nuts and religious fanatics. What I want to ask you is, what type of mentality are we dealing with? How can we get through to them? And how can we possibly convert them?
That's quite a terrific question. I agree with you, by the way, that the 70% there certainly isn't to be interpreted as that many people believing that homosexuality affects the weather in California and a few other items that she has on her list.
Yes.
That's all total nonsense. As a matter of fact, she is a great embarrassment to conservatives. So it is the question of why such a big vote.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a backlash effect, partly, from the liberality of the 60s, but there's more to it than that. No matter how many times you explain to people that this is a constitutional issue and has to do with things like civil rights, you still have a voter thinking, well, now I'm walking into the booth. Am I going to vote for heterosexuality or homosexuality?
Mm-hmm.
And as long as they picture the two as in opposition, you'll have a tendency to get standard conventional thought voted on.
Yeah. Apparently, the problem is that they have these people been brainwashed into believing that, in other words, as many times as the gay lib people will tell them this is a vote for simply to give people equal opportunity, the answer comes back as if they haven't even heard what has been said, this is going to give license for people to commit sodomy. Or if you say, well, this is simply a vote to allow people to live where they want to live, the answer comes back, well, it's going to open the door to child molestation. So you get the idea that somehow they've made themselves impervious to even hearing any kind of rational argument.
That's very true. I've found them quite impervious when I'm talking to them, mm-hmm. too. Furthermore, you get in that Dade County thing, you get all that business about school teachers seducing the children,
yes.
and so on. As a matter of fact, it didn't even have anything to do with anything but private schools. And seduction almost never occurs on the part of a teacher, so rarely that it really is not a problem. If you want to call it a problem, because it happens once in a while, then of course it's a heterosexual
yes.
problem.
I understand the statistics are something 11 out of 12 cases of seduction are heterosexual. Is that an accurate statistic?
That varies anywhere from 9 to 12 mm-hmm. out of 12. But the amount of heterosexuality is obviously much more.
Yeah. But my question is, when these people have obviously been regaled with these statistics, why do they choose to remain impervious to them?
Well, you know, you wake up sleeping dogs the second that you get anywhere near the topic. For instance, sex researchers become outrageous right away in a conversation like that because they, of course, have to point out other things, such mm-hmm. as most of the seduction is done by the children to the teacher and not from the teacher to the children, and that the die is already cast by then, and it's really unheard of for someone to be... made into a heterosexual or a homosexual by early seduction. You might also have to explain that most people who turn out to be homosexual have an earlier history of heterosexual activity and petting mm-hmm. than do heterosexuals. We know exactly why that is, but it's extremely hard to... Each one of these items you have to stop and explain. For right. example, one of the things that... goes with the person being very attracted to a partner is hesitation. Therefore, the young homosexual is much less, homosexual male is much less afraid to approach women than the heterosexual male. Mm-hmm. The result is that his heterosexual tryouts tend to predate those of heterosexuality. Mm-hmm. But each item that you get into is an exact reversal of what you'd think it would be. You would think that the higher homosexuality was, the more it would threaten the birth rate. The reverse is true. The higher the homosexuality, the higher the birth rate. And not just in our society or in Western society, but in every civilization and every tribe.
Seems paradoxical.
We know exactly why that is, but to stop and explain it is, again, another item.
Impervious. Well, perhaps if we can get them to take a look at Dr. Tripp's book, The Homosexual Matrix, something might get through their brains. I wish we had an awful lot more time to talk with Dr. Tripp, but unfortunately we don't. I thank you, sir, very much for being with us this evening. This is Ken Kleiben, and thank you very much for being with us this evening on Emerald City.
The sun, rising on a sea of glass. The ship, a poem of wind, canvas, and a gently rolling deck. Your companions, men who share your lifestyle and your longing for a simpler world. A world of adventure and romance. Uninhibited fun. A dream? Maybe it was once. But late this summer, Firebird Travel can put you on a windjammer. A proud master of the seas. With people who know what kind of vacation you've been dreaming about since you read Treasure Island. But don't put off finding out about this fabulous Firebird Windjammer cruise too long. The ship only holds so many. Call Firebird Travel today at 686-0733 or drop by our office at 370 Lexington Avenue in New York City. It's your headquarters for gay adventures.
Hello, this is Harry Har Brown with the news. This is being taped 2 days after Anita won and did a jig.